the magic when my thoughts and fantasy.
I guess another thing that I can also share is that, you know, one of the things that I feel make me more unique in a good way is the way that I, due to whatever I suffered growing up with my father, I became someone who has an extremely agile empathy, and I very often in life even complained that I feel like I'm understanding everyone and nobody is understanding me. And so that's been a very painful factor always in my life. But yeah, having a very hurt, injured dad who's had to suffer lots of traumas, like my mother dying when the baby me was only 16 months old, that was definitely something for my father that was the thing that made his cup overflow too much with whatever else he experienced. And whatever, that's another story, of course, my dad and his life and him. So I grew already while being very small, very young. I already was growing into someone who was growing my empathy, understanding my surroundings. I remember in Denmark meeting, going very often, regularly, to one of the sisters of my grandma. Her name was Vivi. And she had suffered something that had broken her heart, which was her own fault. And that's probably the reason that she suffered with it so much, that it was her own fault. And instead of getting love and that kind of support from her surroundings, she was, of course, just, you know, sent to a doctor or however, but whatever. She ended up on prescribed medications, and of course, as the years went by, it became another medication and another medication, because being permanently on a medication will cause some damage, will cause some problem, some other problem. And so that's how that goes. And I remember already when I was just around 8 years old, I remember already then registering and saying to my grandma, but you know, why is she taking all these pills? She needs love, she needs company. And so already then I started becoming aware of that, you know, we medicate people, but actually what we really need is the healing of love. And yeah. So that's another thing that comes out of an unusual childhood. And also, of course, then I developed a different relationship with death than most people. I never had a problem with my mom being dead. I felt like I didn't really remember her, but then that's probably nature having its ways of doing things, because there was some years that I would play and have my mom sitting invisibly in a chair, which I don't remember, actually. I remember it so vague that I would rather say I don't remember it. And my grandma telling me about it and saying, well, I would come to sit in the sofa chair and you would tell me, no, mom is sitting there. So that I actually don't remember enough to say that I remember it. But I remember being around 4, max 5 years old and asking my grandma, because she would make these comments about my mom watching me from heaven. And so I would ask her one day, like, what happens when we die? And she gave me some short lame explanation of there being nothing and that's it and that's over. And I just remember wondering, looking at her, wondering, wow, she doesn't know, wow. Okay. And then, you know, as a kid, you just move on with your day. You don't stay speculating about that. You just register and go on with the day. And so already then I knew that no, that's not the end. It doesn't. It's not just nothing after death. Now I know for sure. Now I know whatever. In my adult way, now I know. I'm a fan of near-death experiences. I have watched so many of them. Oh, I can't even count them anymore. That's very educational. That gives wow insight. I think I've only seen one story where I wasn't sure if the person was lying or not, if the person was actually just making it up to become interesting for some reason. But then, I don't know. I can't be the judge of that. Like I said, we can't really judge others. That's more of a feeling than a judgment. And so, yeah, I have a different relationship with death. And it's not like I want to die or anything like that. Although I have had times, lots of them, and some of the years not so long ago was quite longish that I would so often look at this guy and be like, come on, just drop something on me. I can't do it myself, these kind of things. But you know, that's when pain is too much and too heavy and too intense, then we may have times like that. But I don't want to die at all, actually, you know. Sure, when my time comes, okay, that's it, you know, no problem. But I do feel this amazing appreciation for this unbelievable planet. Again, the more you travel, the more you realize how unbelievable this planet is and how paradise is here. We just keep messing it up, actually. But yeah, I have a different relationship to lots of things, I guess, in life because of living so different. It was always, it was also not something surprising to me that to start realizing that our world is run by putting people in fear. Yeah, and I guess that's, you know, and it sits in all of us in all different shapes and forms, just the way that we are brought up to feel powerless and small, and when really we are godlike beings created in his image, right? Also. And we are magical, and I have done things where I myself was like, couldn't believe what I managed to do. That was a complete magic without any exaggeration there. Yeah, that's another topic to get into. How my experience of what I would call magic, divine magic, it has really no rules. It's got something to do with your emotion, the intense emotion and the intent that you have along with it. And then with these feelings and some visuals is how you sort of communicate with whatever, what is, what your soul, God, the ether, all of it. And that's how you then manage to have an effect, to make something happen, or to make something change, or to bring something about. It's not something I've practiced, it's something that has happened, and I have noticed it about 3 times in my life, or 4, or whatever, or I think 3 times in my life mainly. Then there's just other little hints here and there happening. Beginning of my 30s, I came across Esther Hicks. What do they call Jerry and Esther Hicks? Jerry is now dead since some years. But Esther Hicks still works. What she does is she channels some spirit or something, some soul, somebody that used to live called Abraham. I don't know which Abraham it is. There's so many Abrahams. But basically what she's teaching is you know how to create one's life purposefully and intentionally, and how to manifest things, how to make things happen, how to this and that, all that kind of stuff. And from that, a memory came up that when I was about, also I think it was 8, my grandma used to send me to buy her weekly magazine and her cigarettes or something, and she used to give me money for me to buy some either sweeties or some whatever stuff I was interested in. I would also usually buy some magazines for me with horses or some funny stuff, or I wasn't the biggest candy mouth in the world, candy person. And so this one time that she didn't give me money, and I had to go to the kiosk on that day, which was the farthest away, but unfortunately she didn't have any money to give me that day, so I walked up there to the faraway kiosk, and as I was a bit more than halfway there, I was passing this kind of like a field area. It wasn't the real field, but something like that, like the big grass area. And I suddenly looked up at the sky, and I remember saying like, yeah, so God or Jesus or approximately something like that, or whatever you are, whatever it is, to basically I was asking for 20 Danish kroner, as my grandma normally would have given to me, and and yeah, and then I guess I said thank you, and then I immediately forgot about it, as a kid will just, be distracted by the next thing that the eyes fall on, and boom, the mind is somewhere else, and so I forgot about it. But the first thing I did when I came into the kiosk was exactly how Esther Hicks, or Abraham Hicks as they call it, describes the way to do things, that you then start behaving as if what you wish has already come true, and that's exactly what I did. I came into the store, and the first thing I did was to go to the things that I would go to if I had the 20 kroner for me. And then, as I stood there, at some point, I realized, wow, Mila, you better stop spacing out here, or my grandma is gonna get worried because, suddenly the time just flies, woo, and I don't notice, and then she gets worried, and so I remembered that and thought of that. And told myself, okay, stop doing this, hanging here, go there to the register and get the stuff for her, So I went to the register where people were standing in line, and as I was approaching that line, I noticed that on the floor there was 20 kroner, and my first reaction was, wow, that was fast. And then, strangely enough, I bent to pick it up, and as I was picking it up, as I was down there, I realized, wow, what if someone now sees me picking up money from the floor and decides to say, oh, that's mine. And so I look up, and nobody was even seeing me. It was like I wasn't even there to anybody. So I just picked it up and took it, and wow, and okay. And so I got the stuff for my grandma, and then after I went and got some stuff for me, and then I went home and told her about it. And so, yeah. So these kind of little things that we experience in life, this is to me all the little hints and dots, to connect with the bigger everything. But yeah, so to me, this kind of, magic, divine magic, I have to say divine magic so that some people, too many people, would hear the word magic and they immediately think of bad, dark things. No, magic as such is not good or bad. So, but okay, divine magic is something that we can all do. That is my belief. That is the way I've experienced it. That is definitely my belief. It's just a matter of, like I said, intense emotion combined with an intent and some visuals. So, yeah, emotion, intent. And visual imagination. These are the three main things. And whenever my emotions was really intense, but really, really intense, even if it was, like anger or hurt, as long as I could manage to put my demands and all that stuff about it through my heart so that it would be heartfelt, so that wisdom wouldn't be lacking. Really, that's when magical things happened, and it's pretty instant, it's pretty fast, it can be the next day, it can be once it was just within about an hour or so. And then there was this one time that I did it totally unintentional, that I basically wrote a poem, a poem that was full of emotion and intent, and it had some visuals of my imaginations to it as well, and it was the longest, my favorite poem that I ever wrote. And I think about a maybe, I don't know, some few months later, like maybe 3 months time, 2, 3 months later, I actually found myself totally in that whatever the poem was describing. I ended up reading through the poem, and as I was reading through it, I realized, wow, everything what I wrote in this poem, all of that has happened in this past 3 months. So that was unintentional. And that could, yeah, sure be a coincidence too, but this past years leading up to what became this crazedemic all over the planet, the years coming up to that period, I was having so many experiences that I almost every day ended up saying, wow, I don't believe in coincidence anymore. So, well, sure, sometimes, of course. If you can name it, then you know it exists in some way, shape, or form of another. Yeah.